certain, O faithless generation, how long am I to be with you? How long am I to bear with you? Bring him to me. And they brought the boy to him, and when the spirit saw Jesus, immediately it convulsed the boy, and he fell on the ground and rolled about, foaming at the mouth. And Jesus asked his father, how long has he had this? And he said, from childhood. And it has often cast him into the fire and into the water to destroy him. But if you can do anything, have pity on us and help us. And Jesus said to him, if you can believe, all things are possible to him who believes. Immediately the father of the child cried out and said with tears, Lord, I believe, help my unbelief. And when Jesus saw that a crowd came running together, he rebuked the unclean spirit, saying to it, you dumb and deaf spirit, I command you, come out of him and never enter him again. And after crying out and convulsing him terribly, it came out, and the boy was like a corpse. So then most of them said, he is dead. But Jesus took him by the hand and lifted him up, and he arose. And when Jesus had entered the house, his disciples asked him privately, why could we not cast it out? And Jesus said to them, this kind cannot be driven out by anything but prayer and fasting. They went out from there and passed through Galilee, and Jesus would not have anyone know it, for he was teaching his disciples, saying to them, the Son of Man will be delivered into the hands of men, and they will kill him. And after he is killed, he will rise on the third day.
Therefore went out, and the other disciple, meaning John, and were going to the tomb. But they both ran together, and the other disciple, being John, outran Peter and came to the tomb first. And he, stooping down and looking in, saw the linen cloths lying there, yet he did not go in. Then Simon Peter came following him and went into the tomb and saw the linen cloths lying there. You have Mary Magdalene, who had gone like the other women to the tomb to anoint the body of Christ. But our good Lord has overcome death, and his body was not there. He was risen. And that faithful woman told the disciples. And John and Peter, this comes from John's gospel. John and Peter ran to the tomb to see if what Mary Magdalene had said was true. But one of the disciples outran the other one. John got there first. And Peter followed. It's a strange message to hear about two disciples running, but one of them gets there first. And what we're told by the fathers is that these two saints represent something. John was the beloved disciple that laid at Christ's breast. And you don't hear about Christ condemning John. You hear about John always doing what he's supposed to do. And the message that we get from this race is that obedience outruns repentance. Because we remember Peter, that bold disciple who said, "I will never ever leave you, Lord. No matter if everyone else denies you, I won't deny you." But what do we remember on the night that Christ was taken prisoner? Not once, not twice, but three times Peter denied him. But we know Peter's life didn't end there. He remorsefully wept, and he turned his life back to Christ. And this tells us that there's two ways to get to Christ. One is through obedience, by following him and doing what he tells you to do. But if you're like me, you lost that a long time ago. I messed up. So our Lord gives us another path. And that path is repentance, turning to him. And though John may have got there first, obedience may get you there faster. Guess what? So does repentance. It may take you on a few windy roads, but there's no road that can't lead to Christ. God might not choose for us to go this way, but even if we do, he'll give us a path maybe to walk exactly backwards and come to the same starting point with tears. But we have to be willing to do this, my brothers and sisters in Christ. This Sunday we celebrate St. John Climacus, who's known as St. John of the Ladder. And one of the reasons he's called the Ladder is because he wrote a guide for monks with 30 rungs on how to attain the kingdom of heaven that Christ so much desires to give us. But one of the first rungs is denial of the world, renouncing the world, realizing that all this world has to offer is fleeting. All the power of this world, all the honor of this world, all the wealth of this world are nothing compared to God and his glory. And so the first thing that we must do, if we choose to go on this road, if you've already been obedient, you just keep walking as you're walking. That's the best route. But if you're like this priest, you have to repent. And you have to go backwards. And we have to empty out ourselves. God created us good. We know that. What God makes is good. But we listen. Instead of listening to the angels who tells us to look this way or to walk this way, quite often we allow our ears to hear the voice of the demons. And they're real. The Orthodox Church doesn't say that demons aren't real. We know that they're real. And if we could see what they really look like, the worst horror movie couldn't describe them. They're so hideous. But in contrast to that is your guardian angel, who stands by you, who guides you, pushing you not towards earthly glory, but towards the kingdom of heaven. But quite often we listen to that other sound. And it's because of that that we need repentance. We need this self-emptying. Because God created us so pure and so good. But we said, let me move out Christ. Let me move out Christ so I can put some worldly things into my life. And what we think is good, is shiny, turns out to be a fool's gold and leads us on a path that isn't good. So many times, young people, I'm sure you think, doesn't it feel good to rebel? Doesn't it feel good to not do what my parents told me to do? Look how free I am. But then we find out, wow, mom was right. Dad was right. And so we follow again the voice of mom or dad. But before we do that, we first have to admit that we were wrong. We first have to admit that God expected something from us and we didn't give it to him. But that's okay. That's okay. Today, there's a strange story about a boy who from his birth has been troubled and somehow has been possessed by demons. The father says that he often casts himself into the water and casts himself into the fire, the two things that can destroy mankind, that God created man to be over. But because of our fallen nature, we've become suppressed by fire. We've become suppressed by water. And the disciples started to try to heal him, but they couldn't do it. But they couldn't do it. But Christ has mercy on the boy. He says, how long am I to endure with this generation? Meaning this faithless generation that doesn't know that I'm more powerful than any sin or any disease. And he says, step aside. And if you remember, there's a battle between Christ and the demons. So much that the boy began convulsing. Because sin, whatever it is, however much we allow it into our lives, tries to take over us. Sin wants to just knock at your door, but then it wants you to let it sit on your couch. Then it wants you to serve it food. And that place that used to belong to you and your guardian angel have now been overtaken by the devil and his demons. And so if we tell that demon to leave, guess what? He doesn't want to leave. So there's going to be a fight. And that's why the boy was convulsing, because he had become so accustomed to the demon dwelling inside of him. But our Lord is more powerful than any demon. And that's why he doesn't let the fight go down. He casts him out. And what happened? They thought the boy was dead. Because that had become so much a part of him that his true self had been buried. But our Lord said, no, he's still alive. Give him something to eat. He's still alive. Because I've raised him up. Because I've taken care of him. And then the disciples say, why couldn't we have done that? And what does the Lord answer? Because you didn't pray and you didn't fast enough. What he's saying is, you're still connected to the earthly world. You haven't completely let yourself go to the hands of God. Because that's where all power comes from. The hands of God. And that's what Christ does. He's fully obedient to the hands of God. How does the gospel end? After this great miracle, you'd think there'd be a celebration. But what does Christ say? He said, the Son of Man will be delivered in the hands of men who desire to kill him. He's reminding you that it's through complete obedience, even to the point of death, that we achieve God's will. And that's what Christ was ready to do. And the disciples weren't ready to completely give themselves up yet. They weren't ready to completely empty themselves out. Because it's only when we fully empty ourselves out that Christ can come and dwell in us. You know, we have seen tragedy. A young boy, a child of God, was taken from this earth. But his faithful parents mourn and continue to mourn. And this community mourns with them. But we know that they have given him into the hands of God. Just like this young boy. This young boy that we hear about in the gospel was raised up by Christ, but he continued facing an earthly life. We know that our Lord, through that image right there, just as he raises Adam and Eve and all of humanity, pulls up all the children with him and says, "Come. Come, blessed of my Father, enter the kingdom that has been prepared for you." He's already there. But we who are still on this earth must continue to struggle, must continue to battle with the demons. And it's a deathly fight. Because if we give in, all that our Lord has done for us will be for naught, for us. Even though there's resurrection, if we don't follow his commandments, we've all been resurrected. But what have we been resurrected to? To judgment or to life? That's the question. We will all be resurrected. But for some, it may not be good news. But for those who are pure, those who are childlike, those who are loving, it's to resurrection. And that's why we who are still on this earth have to make those choices to cut away those things from our lives which are sinful. Don't let the devil tell you it's become part of you. It hasn't. It may have, but you can cut it off. Just like cancer, just like a tumor. You know, it takes a long time when someone has a tumor removed from their body for them to heal. But they know it was better to not be there. But there's still a time of healing. And that's how it is when we cut ourselves away from sin. My brothers and sisters in Christ, on this Sunday of St. John Climacus, let us hear but one quote from this man. He says, "Let us who are weak and passionate have the courage to offer our infirmity and natural weakness to Christ with unhesitating faith, and confess it to him, and we shall be certain to obtain his help, even beyond our worth, if we only continually plunge to the depth of humility. Man offers, and God purifies. Man seeks, and God gives. Man weeps, and God saves. Man falls, and God lifts him up. Man sins and God heals. Man falls again. God swiftly saves again. Man despairs and God gladdens and consoles. Man kills himself by sin, but God raises the dead, casts out demons, and completely destroys the deadly passions and sin." We are in a warfare, my brothers and sisters in Christ. But our general, our Christ, has already carried the victory sign. In 2 weeks from now, we'll be walking around the church with palms, remembering Lazarus, that Christ raised Lazarus from the dead. He has power over death. He has power over our enemy. Follow him. Be in his army. Say no. Say no whenever someone else tries to enlist you in their army. Because our Lord has already shown that he's conquered. To that great conqueror over death.